Today's video is one that I know a lot of people have been very much looking forward to, and one that I also am very excited to do, finally. So today we're going to be doing, on today's species spotlight, the Eastern Indigo. Now, the Eastern Indigo is the longest colubrid in North America. They are an amazing, beautiful species of snake. The Eastern Indigo is very endangered, and they are found in basically the most southeastern part of the United States, parts of Florida, Alabama, and Georgia. Now, these guys are amazing, amazing animals. I'm gonna do my best not to repeat that like 14 times during this video, but it's just so cool. Now, they are called indigo because in the light, and unfortunately with like the halogen and like the fluorescent light that I have in here, it doesn't show it as very well, but in the sunlight, they have this beautiful natural like blue hue because of the iridophores that they have that we've talked about in a lot of other videos, that they have this really cool blue hue to them, thus the indigo snake. Now, there are several different species of indigo, including the Texas and the Mexican and a couple other ones, but the Eastern Indigo is definitely the most iconic and the most well-known. So these guys, as I said before, are the longest species of colubrid in North America. Males average 5 to 6 feet in length, and females about 4.5 to 5.5 feet long. The males of actually a lot of species of colubrids are actually larger than the boas and pythons that we're used to, because the boas and pythons have such large clutches, and in the case of boas, large litters, that the female's body needs to accommodate that for. The indigos and colubrids in general, they don't have usually as large of eggs or as large clutches or litters, so usually the males, it's more of like a dominance combative thing that we think of more traditionally like with mammals and birds and things like that, where they're actually a little bit larger. Now, just because they are in fact averaging 5 to 6 feet long, the longest recorded male Eastern indigo was actually just over 8 feet long, which is huge. So basically they kind of come in right under the Eastern diamondback as the longest and largest species of snake in general, but they're definitely the largest colubrid species of snake. Now, with that being said, these guys are endangered. And in fact, they were put on the endangered species list back in 1978. So they've been endangered for quite some time as a result of several other things, including habitat fragmentation, deforestation, poaching, killing off, human encroachment, and the poaching specifically due to the exotic pet trade, although there haven't been any wild collected ones since the 80s, even after it became illegal. These guys became very rare and very hard to find. Now, just like the Louisiana pine snake and the North American crocodile, or the freshwater crocodile, they are some of the reptiles that have had the most work put into and conservation efforts put into restoring these guys's habitats. And a lot of the reason why these guys, in addition to the things that we talked about, why they're so endangered is, in fact, they have smaller clutches and larger eggs. And they also require very specific habitats. So these guys, their clutch averages usually about 6 eggs, where normally with pythons it's a lot more. And they don't have them as often. They take a little bit longer to get going. So usually instead of like, you know, 2 or 3 years old, sometimes 4 years old, these guys were thinking about 5, 6, 7 years old to when they are really start healthy, when they're able to breed, especially females. They really need that size because they have very large eggs as well. They have small clutches, large eggs, and then their habitat is very, very critical for them to be able to survive. Now, in the case of like, say, the Louisiana pine snake, they have very specific habitat, those old growth longleaf pine forests. These guys, they don't need as specific, but they do have very specific requirements that they do in fact need to be able to survive in their ones. So when we look at the habitat of them, the thing that stands out the most about indigos is they have huge, basically home ranges, which isn't something that a lot of people think about when it comes to reptiles. That's like really like a mammal thing that most people think about. But these guys in fact do have home ranges. And males in fact typically average 400 to 600 acres is their home range. And females are even larger, with sometimes closer to 1,200 square acres. So, you know, think well over a mile that they will, in fact, travel and cover. And the reason why they have such large habitats is because throughout the year, they require different things and different habitats that they need based on the time of the year. So they usually need well-drained soil, sandy soil. They also need specific things where their diets come from, different places for them to hide and retreat and to brumate during the hottest parts of the year as well as the coldest parts of the year. And in fact, in the northern part of their range, so when we think about of their range, so Florida, they're usually found down in the very small tip of Florida. and then their range is also kind of broken up a little bit into Alabama and Georgia. In the northern part of it, where it gets much colder, where it can actually dip below freezing, they require, really they do, gopher tortoise burrows, which are also another very keystone species that over 200 different species rely on their burrows for their survival. The indigos are definitely at the top of that list. And so as the gopher tortoise habitat decreases due to, you know, like Walmart parking lots and things like that, places for the indigo to be able to hibernate slash broodmate, because that's actually the more correct term, in those farther northern parts of their range, also become harder and harder to find. Now, when we talked about all the different parts of the habitats, what I said, like when you think about the lower part of their habitat, it's much more diverse. They can be found in farmlands, in grasslands, and kind of more deserty areas that all encompass this huge home range that they have. Parts of those different habitats are all part of that, because throughout the year, they will eat different things. Now, that being said, these guys belong to the genus of snake called drymarchon, which in Latin means Lord of the Forest. And I've talked about this in like the different Kribo videos, but Lord of the Forest means they are truly the lords of the forest. These guys are apex predators. We all know king snakes, right? Well, we get that name king snake because they eat other snakes. These guys eat everything. King snakes do as well, but these guys eat mammals, they eat birds, they eat reptiles, they eat baby tortoises, baby freshwater turtles, they eat baby alligators, other indigos, venomous snakes like eastern diamondbacks, pygmy rattlesnakes, king snakes. They truly are the lords of the forest. Really, the only thing that these guys have to worry about are large birds of prey, large mature alligators, bobcats, and people. That's really about it. These guys truly are large and impressive snakes. They are amazing. Now, that being said, in captivity, it's a little bit of a challenge when it comes to keeping the species. So as I mentioned before, they're endangered, have been for a very long time. That means that if you want to keep these, you have to either find a breeder in your state, or you have to require special permitting through U.S. Fish and Wildlife to be able to actually transport them in between the states, because we need to keep track of that. Now, the other thing about that is these guys have had such a limited stock for a very long time. Again, being back endangered since 1978, there haven't been a whole lot of these guys around. A lot of their genetics can be traced back to very specific animals. And because of that, they're very inbred. And because of that inbreeding, there are a lot of genetic issues, including, but not limited to, enlarged hearts, problems with cancer, tumor development, and split belly scales, where their belly scales here, these little scutes, they're actually split in between, which hampers their mobility and even sometimes their ability to digest things properly. That also has to do with like other internal organ things. Think about like the cheetahs. Remember that the cheetah population dwindled down so much like back in the 90s, where it was a really big issue that we were dealing with possibly losing the cheetah populations, but due to conservation efforts, we're able to actually have cheetahs. The same thing too with these guys. There are some very select breeders of Eastern Indigos that are actually doing blood and genetic testing so that way they can have the most unrelated and healthy clutches to be able to reproduce and sustain healthy populations of indigos, because they actually did a survey back in the early 2000s, and they found that a large majority of eastern indigos are over 50% related. Now, with reptiles, inbreeding and lion breeding, they seem to withstand some of those genetic issues a little bit better than, say, like mammals and birds. Not these guys. They're a little bit more susceptible to it when we talk about those enlarged hearts and split belly scales and things like that. So because of that, those, you know, dedicated breeders where we're getting those very outcrossed or as outcrossed as we can clutches and breedings are really a necessity for these guys. So with that being said, if you do decide you want to keep one, the first thing is find a good breeder, someone that has a good track record, that can show the lines where they come from, maybe even the people that are actually doing that genetic testing that we talked about. And then when we have to talk about keeping these guys, these are large, active, intelligent, diurnal snakes. So what that means is they need huge enclosures. They need places to hide, so hide boxes and lay boxes and things like that are a necessity, but they need very large enclosures. They will absolutely take advantage of that. Full spectrum lighting is a really good idea. It'll help them metabolize their food and move around a little bit more. Now, with that being said, these guys, like a lot of the other drymarchon species like the Kribos, their metabolisms are a little bit faster than, say, like the ball pythons that we're used to, which means instead of eating every week or larger meals, these guys eat much more often and usually smaller meals, and they don't digest their food quite as well as other ones have been before. In fact, more than one indigo keeper and breeder I've talked to have found whole pieces, distinguishing pieces in their excrement, like whole chicken feet, mouse ears, parts of tails, things like that. So that means that they are not digesting their food and getting as much nutrition out as, say, a ball python or a boa constrictor or even a corn snake. So because of that, you're feeding a lot more often and you're dealing with a lot more of what comes out afterwards. So large caging, lots of lighting, lots of food, lots of poop, all of that comes with these guys, as well as a very hefty price tag. Now, this girl is our only one. We acquired her very recently. She is a retired breeder. Her breeding did not go very well last time. A lot of complications, egg binding, all of that jazz. So she is done breeding. She is absolutely done. But still an amazing, amazing snake. These guys are so, so cool. Now, if anyone out there is interested in these guys, please make sure you do your research, get in contact, go into Facebook groups, learn as much as you can about this amazing species of snake. I, for one, think would be amazing to be able to work with and be able to breed, now that I actually do get to work with, but be able to breed this really cool species of snake. I don't know if it's going to happen personally. There's a lot of inherent risk when it comes to breeding any animal, reptiles especially. There's a lot that can happen. And with these guys, that already that can happen, as well as being more susceptible to issues with the large clutches, all of the other things. It's something that I don't ever really want to, I don't want to say deal with, but it's not something that I don't know if I'll be able to do, as well as she will never be in that breeding program as well. So with that being said, I hope you guys did enjoy this. If you noticed that a lot of the other footage here was also part of my, what are you doing, silly girl? Were part of my friend's collection, just like those the white-lipped pythons that we had before. So if you want to check that out, you can actually see, as a funny little bit of a tidbit about these guys, is that they actually have two different color phases. This is actually a black phase, where if you look really close, under their chin and on their neck, sometimes it's almost pure black, a lot of times it's a little bit more faded and just not as vibrant and bright. And then there's the red phase, where it's actually more red, orangey color. And you can see that several of her animals, in fact, have that really, really cool coloration. Now, keeping these guys, it's really cool to think about keeping this endangered species, but that is something that we want to talk about, is that this is an animal that we will never get new fresh blood from the wild because of how endangered they are. But as full circle in this video, we talked about these guys have been a part of conservation efforts for decades now. They have now actually been found in the wild for the second time in well over 60 years in Alabama, and part of the range that was part of their historic range that they haven't been seen for a while. And this is a wild-born animal, not one that was bred and released by several of the captive breeding programs that we have. Us hobbyists, we're not part of that, but we are part of hopefully being able to keep natural stock and healthy stock for these guys if something catastrophic were to happen. As well as for the very first time since the 80s, they have been released into the Apalachicola, which I probably mispronounced that, and people from Appalachia and Appalachia are going to yell at me, because there's no matter how I say that, I'm wrong. But they have been now found in the Apalachicola River Range in the panhandle of Florida, which is part of their northern range of these guys that requires that specific habitat that we talked about. They have been released there and are seen to be doing very, very well. So, hooray, we have successes. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. I do have a tendency to kind of really go on about stuff that I'm very, very passionate about, if you couldn't tell. I'm very excited to be able to work with such an amazing, crazy species. If you guys enjoyed this video or you want to learn more about other different species, I have a full playlist of species spotlights. I'm getting close to 40 just different species. Suggestions, comments, anything like that, let me know down below. Hope everyone's having a great day, and we'll check you next time.